Let's now work with the y momentum equation. It will be exactly the same thing. We'll take the dimensional form and then non-dimensionalize it. So the first term there is rho times vx. For that I am going to write down u times vx star. And for the vy, it is uy by L del Vy star by del X star. So that's the first term. And let me simplify this right away. This would become rho u, and here I would get Vx star del Vy star by del X star. And I will substitute for ui. Ui is given as delta times u by L. Okay, so that is what I am going to get for this term. And then the next term would be plus rho delta u square by L square vy star del vy star by del y star. For the pressure term, I am going to get rho u square
by L
by delta, actually, because now I have del p star by delta y star. And then I have to write down
the viscous terms. They are going to be
delta u
by
L cube del square V y star by del X star square plus
the second derivative of the y velocity,
which would be u
times delta
by L delta square del square v y star by del y star square. Okay. For this equation, what I will do is divide everywhere by this quantity, which is essentially rho u square by L times delta. Let me make some space. So this would give us, so I am continuing on the y momentum equation. So all I have done is taken the equation up there and divide everywhere by rho u square delta by L, and I would get the following: Vx star del Vy star by del X star plus Vy star del Vy star by del y star. So that is the convection term. Then the pressure gradient term, which would be L square by delta square del p star by del y star. And then here I would get, I will already substitute for the Reynolds number because you are aware of it now, del square V y star by, that is the first term, and then the next term would be plus 1 over R e delta square by L square
times
del square V y star by, this I am sorry is x square.
So this is your non-dimensional equation. Let us number these terms. So this I will call as t1, this as t2, t3, t4, t5. I want to argue which of these terms are important. Okay, that is the question I want to ask. So these terms are obviously of the order of 1, no doubt about that. Similarly, t2 is of the order of 1. Okay. I already know that this term over here, del p star by del y star, if it is of the order of 1, then the coefficient L square by delta square is very large, and this would become extremely large. That cannot happen. So this term has to be maximum of the order of 1. Okay, so this entire term has to be of the order of 1 at the most. And what that would imply is that del p star by del y star is actually of the order of, so if I look at the order of this term, this should be the inverse of that, so it should be delta by L whole square, which is actually much, much less than 1, because delta is very small. As you know, delta by L whole square is of the order of 1 by Reynolds number. So I am able to conclude from this that if these are the convective terms and the pressure terms have to be at the most of this size, they cannot be larger, then you know, this del p star by del y star has to be very small, and therefore what it means is that the pressure variation across the boundary layer is negligible. Okay, so this term actually implies that pressure variation across boundary layer is negligible. That's very interesting. What it tells me is that if I have an airfoil and if I had a boundary layer, then whatever, if I took a section here, then the pressure across the boundary layer, that means the variation in the pressure here, is negligible. So whatever is the pressure I feel at the edge of the boundary layer is going to be the pressure that I feel on the airfoil itself, which really means that if I did not have a separated flow, it's an attached flow, then if I am able to compute or estimate the pressure through a potential flow analysis or an inviscid flow analysis, okay, that actually holds even at the edge of the boundary layer. So it's a very important conclusion. Let's come back to these terms. I already know that these two are the viscous terms and they cannot be larger than order of 1, okay, because that's the maximum that I can have. Out of that, this term is very small because it's of the order of 1 by Re. So this term is small because of 1 by Re. This term, on the other hand, could be important, okay, because I have delta square by L square varying as 1 over Re. So in fact this term also would be very small, okay. So this term is of the order of 1 by Re. Okay. So overall, my conclusion from this equation is it doesn't give me anything meaningful. Okay, the only thing is it tells me that I will use the fact that del p by del y can be neglected. Okay. So now let me therefore write down the boundary layer equations for you after this analysis. So let's now write down what are my boundary layer equations. So the first is the continuity equation. There is no change to that. It remains as is. So I get del Vx by del x plus del Vy by del y equal to 0. Then I have the x momentum equation, and I have the y momentum equation. Let me first write the y momentum equation because that's fairly simple. This we have seen tells us that del p by del y is 0 inside the boundary layer, which really implies that p is only a function of x, so I can replace del p by del x with dp by dx. How about the x momentum equation? I'll have to retain the convection term. So the first term is Vx del Vx by del x. The next term is Vy del Vx by del y, and of course they have to be multiplied with the density. Then I have the pressure gradient, but this time I can write it as dp dx simply because my pressure is only a function of x. Next I come to the viscous terms. So I have shown that the first term, which is the del square Vx by del x square, is negligible, so no need to keep it, and we are going to get del square Vx by del y square. Okay, so these are your boundary layer equations. They are much simpler than the full Navier-Stokes equations, because you can see pretty much we have now two main equations. The third one is really already taken care of in this equation. Okay. What about the boundary conditions? For the far stream, the same conditions as in the Navier-Stokes, but there is no far stream here. Okay, we are inside the boundary layer. So therefore, the conditions that we really need to apply are on the solid surface and at the edge of the boundary layer. So let me write that down. So on the surface, we are going to say that the velocity at y equal to y surface, or maybe I should say x equal to x surface, this is the body surface, would be same as the velocity of the body. In fact, if it is a stationary body, so for stationary surface, I would have to satisfy the no slip boundary condition, and then my Vx is 0 and my Vy is 0 on body. Then I have to have an additional boundary condition at y equal to delta, at the edge of the boundary layer. And there the condition would be that my speed at y equal to delta at every x should be actually the free stream speed vector times 0.99. So at the edge of the boundary layer, the flow achieves 99% of the free stream speed. So I'll have to solve these two boundary layer equations along with these two conditions. Okay. Let's see what happens for a flat plate. For a flat plate, I have some simplifications. First of all, my pressure gradient dp dx is 0. Okay. So I can get rid of this term. So my equations become del Vx by del x plus del Vy by del y is 0. And then I have rho Vx del x plus Vy del Vx del y. This is mu times del square Vx by del y square. These are the equations that govern the boundary layer on a flat plate. And my boundary conditions would be simply that Vx equal to Vy is 0 at y equal to 0. That's the surface of the plate. And Vx equal to 0.99 times the free stream speed at y equal to delta. One would expect that this equation is easy to solve. Unfortunately, no. It needs a numerical solution. So the solution was proposed by Blasius, and that's why it's called a Blasius boundary layer solution. using self-similarity. He made a very smart observation. What he argued is the following. He said that if this is my flat plate and the horizontal axis is the x-axis, that's my y, then I would get profiles at different locations. So that's my boundary layer here, and of course far away it is a uniform flow. And as my boundary layer thickens, so let me draw a profile here, then I would have the same free stream, but now I have a thicker boundary layer. So this is the boundary layer thickness at this location, and this of course is the boundary layer thickness at another location. So he argued the following. He said that if I non-dimensionalize y with delta, so let's define eta as y by delta. So I take, instead of the y coordinate, I take eta for this, so it will always go from 0 to 1 inside the boundary layer. So you can see eta is going to vary between 0 to 1. And I am going to define my f as vx by u. Okay. And this also f will go between 0 and 1. So there is no flow separation, and I am assuming that the speed is 0 here, and of course it is close to 1, 99% of 1 at the edge of the boundary layer. He argued that if I plotted these f as a function of eta, okay, then this does not depend on x. So I could get the same profile, a template, and I just keep on expanding it by using a delta, and I can get a profile at different values of x. So that's a very smart thing he did, and he simplified these equations further. I'm not going to go into the details. You can read that up. And what he was able to show is that with this analysis, found a numerical solution. In fact, he was able to reduce this problem of partial differential equation into an ordinary differential equation. Okay, and he was able to solve that on a computer. So he was able to show that tau wall, which is the shear stress, which of course is defined as mu del Vx by del y at y equal to 0, this is given as 0.332 times rho u square by square root of Rex. So he defined a Reynolds number based on x, which means if this is my x, then I can define a Reynolds number x as rho u x by mu. Okay. And that's what he found the tau wall to be. From this, he was able to come up with Cf, which is the skin friction coefficient, and you all know by now what is the skin friction coefficient. It is the non-dimensional tau wall. So tau wall, it is non-dimensionalized with half rho u square, the dynamic pressure. And this we can work out would be 0.664 divided by square root of Re. Once I know this, then I can ask myself, what if the length of my plate is L? Okay, so I drag a plate through water and I want to find out what is the frictional drag or the resistance it will encounter. So I can use this formula, and at least for one side of the plate, okay, if both sides are exposed, then of course you would have a boundary layer on the upper and lower surface. But assuming that only one side is exposed, I can actually calculate the drag coefficient. So let me do that for you.